As 2021 came to a close, two major franchises unburied the past to indulge our nostalgia. Sometimes, this results in a hollow experience, which only reminds us that the things we miss are truly gone. Other times, a great writer or director can find a new story, or just something new to say, which justifies the existence of a sequel, reboot, remake, or whatever you label it. In December 2021, one of those properties did it right, and the other was Matrix Resurrections. To be fair, Spider-Man No Way Home only had to tell a good story, whereas we've come to expect more from The Matrix. Ideally, we'd like to see a great story, but beneath that, we'd also like there to be meaning. Resurrections certainly aims for both, but if you were hoping Lana Wachowski would have something new to say, you'll be disappointed. In general, the Wachowskis have remained silent on the meaning of those first three movies. Their belief was that if they spoke out about its meaning, it would diminish viewers' subjective experiences. We would take their word as gospel and stop wrestling with our interpretation. Well, The Matrix Resurrections gets so meta, Lana Wachowski has effectively broken her silence. Rather than add new meaning to the series, she's used the latest installment to resurrect themes from the original, remove any subtlety, and loudly repeat them to ensure no misunderstanding. There's an unmistakable frustration written into this movie which reads like, "People didn't get the original Matrix, so I'm going to finally spell it out for all of you." I don't necessarily have an issue with repeating themes, especially some which are inherent to the Matrix's story, but in the 2.5 hour runtime, it becomes tiresome, and there just wasn't enough new to counterbalance it. Although Reloaded and Revolutions had their share of problems, they added and refined the original's themes, without repeating too much. I'll get into more specifics on all this in a couple of minutes when I go into spoilers, but first, a few words on the story. On the surface level, the original Matrix was a pretty traditional hero story. Thomas Anderson discovered a strange new world where he found strength and love, then saved the day. But it stood out thanks to sci-fi concepts, new to most of us at the time, combined with incredible action sequences that incorporated novel effects that, again, most of us hadn't seen before. Then Revolutions happened. With the focus shifting to the siege at Zion and away from the great action inside the Matrix, one attraction of the series disappeared, and with much of the focus on characters we had little connection to, the hero story we enjoyed in the original also mostly disappeared. So besides some of the interesting developments in the theme, the movie became a more hollow experience. Unfortunately, that's mostly what Resurrections felt like to me too. At least 50% of the story felt just as hollow and boring as the Battle of Zion. The action all felt generic and typical for the 2020s, and as I said before, the movie has little to add thematically, other than to repeat what we already know, overtly and loudly, in case we missed it the first time. There is some nostalgic joy in seeing a couple of beloved characters reunited, and I think that's explicitly one point of the movie, but in the context of everything else I mentioned, even that mostly fell flat for me. To be honest, I won't say I outright hated this movie, but it's hard not to be disappointed, and after watching it a second time, I doubt I could ever bring myself to watch it a third time. And now, I'll get into spoilers. First, quick message from this video's sponsor. After watching Resurrections, or maybe instead of watching it, why not check out a Keanu Reeves classic, The Devil's Advocate, where Al Pacino plays the devil? I know what you're thinking, that movie isn't on Netflix. Well, in Poland it is, and with Surfshark, you can have it too. Surfshark is a VPN service which allows you to access the internet as though you're located somewhere else. So I just click on the browser extension, choose Poland, and now I'm watching The Devil's Advocate. Surfshark is also a great way to get past geo-blocks and government restrictions. Some countries won't allow you to access YouTube, for example. And can you imagine missing the latest one-take video because the government says you can't watch it? With Surfshark, you never have to worry about that. Wherever you are, just connect back to your home country and access all the sites you normally do. Surfshark also keeps you safe and private while you're online by encrypting your data. So the next time you're on public Wi-Fi, turn on Surfshark VPN so you don't have to worry about anyone snooping while you log into your email, bank, or potentially expose any other sensitive data. Use my link in the description and promo code ONETAKE to get 83% off plus 3 months free. And now, back to the Matrix. The movie starts with a new character, Bugs, somehow watching something we've already seen before. The first scene from The Matrix of Trinity kicking ass and running from agents. But Trinity and the other characters are all played by different actors, and things don't happen exactly the way they happened the first time. One of the agents saves her and reveals himself to be digital sentience named Morpheus, code whose purpose is to find Neo. Bugs reveals that she's seen Neo, even though most people think he's dead. One day, she spotted a nondescript man, but when he looked at her, she saw his true form. That awakened her to the false reality of the Matrix. The same thing happened to Morpheus, when he began to see code everywhere. Bugs gives him a red pill to free him from the modal. And what is a modal? It's a sort of pocket simulation that repeats on loop to evolve code. And this particular modal, the one which trapped Morpheus, was programmed by one Thomas Anderson, a game designer responsible for a popular trilogy of video games known as The Matrix. As described, some of that sounds pretty interesting. Why is this version of Morpheus playing the role of an agent? What is the purpose of these modals? And why did Bugs see Neo in the form of another man? But as executed, these opening minutes got me worried. First, the action was inferior to anything we saw in the original. Going in, I wasn't looking for something to revolutionize the genre, but I at least hoped for something a cut above average Hollywood action. But instead, I saw the usual fast cuts used to disguise stunt doubles and avoid the difficult choreography needed for awesome action you can actually see. Then there was the effect of the red pill. When Neo took it in the first Matrix, the effect of it became iconic. Reality warped in the form of a mirror turning liquid and engulfing his body. In this movie, the effect is a sort of slow motion double vision, the kind of effect I would have used in a low budget high school project. The other effect is awful, awkward jokes like Morpheus saying, "This is the first time I've worn different glasses," or his awkwardly picking the wrong door and greeting the agents. Though even before the red pill, there were already some awkward attempts at humor, like Bugs running into the agents and flatly delivering the line, "You all carry on, as you were." Then we get to one of the most polarizing 30 minutes in cinematic history, the meta part of this movie where it seems the original Matrix trilogy was all a game created by programmer Thomas Anderson. He sees the error that Morpheus escaped his modal, then joins his colleague Jude for coffee. The obnoxious coworker rants about how obsessed he was with Anderson's Matrix trilogy. In the reflection on the table, we get a glimpse at the man people see when they look at Neo. Anderson also stares longingly at Tiffany, the married mother who we know is really Trinity. Jude plays wingman and introduces Thomas. There's a brief moment of recognition between Thomas and Tiffany, but she's whisked away by her husband, Chad. Yes, his name is Chad. Everything in this segment of the movie is on the nose, but it sort of worked for me. Once you realize why Thomas is here and who designed this little reality, the obnoxious lack of subtlety felt in character. Then, if things weren't meta enough, Anderson's business partner informs him that Warner Brothers is demanding a new Matrix movie. Sorry, I mean a new Matrix game. By the way, that's one thing that bugged me about this whole section. They keep calling it a game and even show clips from the movies, but call them footage from the game. It's clearly not a game. Like in these scenes, what is the gameplay? I actually bought into the whole meta approach, and I'll talk about that more in a bit. But when they show clips of a movie and call it a game, that was distracting. I thought a few brief clips where scenes from the movie were made to look like a game, and we saw some interpretation of how the gameplay would work, it could have worked a little better. Throughout this sequence, we learn that Thomas took aspects of his life and incorporated them into the game. For example, his boss was the basis for Agent Smith. We also learn that he suffered a psychotic break becoming convinced that the game was based in reality and that he actually does live in a simulation called the Matrix. But his analyst assures him none of that is true, and in fact, giving in to these fantasies is dangerous. It previously resulted in a suicide attempt when Thomas threw himself off a building, something Bugs witnessed when she saw his true form. So, the analyst supplies Thomas with another dose of blue pills to keep him subdued. And we get the montage, where a writer's room pitches ideas for The Matrix 4. The entire thing is parody, where they talk about activating the WTF part of our brains, incorporating bullet time, and making sure the new game has some of that shiny philosophy. It all drives Thomas a little crazy, but he takes a break by grabbing coffee with his crush, Tiffany. She talks about how she wanted a family, but isn't sure if that's just because she was programmed to want that. She also asks if the character of Trinity was based on her. Back at the office, Thomas and everyone else are ordered to evacuate by the FBI, but he gets a text promising that answers await him in the bathroom. And there, he finds Morpheus, or the code version of Morpheus that he created for his modal. Throughout this entire meta sequence, there are a few examples of this movie's removal of subtlety. The first Matrix, especially, deals with the idea that humans get trapped in systems of control. But did you realize that the Wachowskis weren't just talking about computer simulations, but other systems too? Stuff you may even deal with in the real world, like the pressures to have a family, phones that suck away all your attention, and greedy corporations. By moving this movie into a world that feels like our own, where Thomas Anderson has based The Matrix on his experiences, Lana Wachowski essentially yells, "Hey, all that stuff in the old movies was a metaphor, and here are some of the things that metaphor may have stood for." Since its release, people have also tried to pigeonhole the series into rigidly fitting a single allegory. The Matrix was really about trans politics, or greedy capitalism. In the parody writer's room, Lana scoffs at this idea by having the characters share their opinions on what The Matrix really is. Again, if you didn't realize art is usually subjective and intentionally open to interpretation, the movie screams it at you in this scene by having foolish characters take the opposite view. In the original trilogy, there is also the recurring idea of choice as an illusion. Is it really a choice when your experiences and current circumstances inevitably favor one choice over the other? Again, this idea is spelled out more explicitly than ever when Bugs offers Morpheus the red or blue pill. Morpheus scoffs at her, asking, "You call this a choice?" She responds, "Oh, honestly, when somebody offered me these things, I went off on binary conceptions of the world and said there was no way I was swallowing some symbolic reduction of my life." And the woman with the pills laughed, cause I was missing the point. The choice is an illusion. You already know what you have to do. I also saw some of Lana speaking through Bugs, as though the filmmaker is frustrated at how some ideas from the movie have been pilfered and, in her view, misused. Something I found a little distracting. Putting all that aside, there was something in this sequence that worked for me. In the original Matrix, we're told that Neo feels something off in the world. He could tell his reality wasn't quite right, but didn't know the cause. In Resurrections, I felt that in a way I didn't in the original, because we know the Matrix, and seeing Neo's reality filled with familiar references, there is an unsettling feeling that something isn't right. When the montage begins with the parody writer's room pitching ideas for The Matrix 4, there were a few moments that got laughs from me, like Anderson's failed kung fu attempt. But that humor, coupled with the haunting score and Thomas Anderson's disturbed mental state, was unsettling. Again, that first Matrix movie told us something was off in Anderson's reality, but we spent very little time in that world before getting to The Matrix. Resurrections lived in the false reality a bit longer and pushed things further with Anderson's suicide attempt. It shows the danger of that cognitive dissonance when you suspect your world is false. There is also genuine intrigue. I wanted to know why Neo looked different in his reflections. I wanted to know the purpose of the modal he created. And to be honest, there was a minute there where I wondered if they really were going to say the original trilogy never happened. It doesn't take long for us to realize Neo is still inside the Matrix, and the events of the trilogy did happen. But for a moment, I thought they were going to go all the way and say the Matrix was a figment of Thomas Anderson's imagination. Partly, I was influenced by posts on social media before the movie came out, and I figured decanonizing the originals would be enough to draw the ire that I saw. So, putting aside the sometimes frustrating lack of subtlety, I did appreciate the tone of this first act and genuinely bought into the mystery. Neo meets his modal Morpheus. The reasons given for Neo creating him are a little vague at first. Neo calls it an experiment. Though it's later revealed, he likely created the modal in the hopes of freeing himself from his fabricated reality. And it eventually works. For now, Neo still believes he's losing his mind, so he runs. Morpheus begins a shootout with the FBI, and drenched by the fire sprinklers, Neo's business partner wakes up and remembers that he is Agent Smith. And I should point out, I really enjoyed Jonathan Groff's performance. I would have loved for Hugo Weaving to return, and it sounds like scheduling conflicts were the only reason he didn't. But Groff did a great job making the role his own with a calm, sinister demeanor, while still calling back to Hugo Weaving's performance. Yahya Abdul-Mateen II, on the other hand, I thought did a good job with the material he was given, but I just found the character distracting. Other than his desire to find Neo, this Morpheus felt nothing like the old one. And when they later describe him as a character programmed by Neo to share the qualities of both Smith and Morpheus, I just scratched my head because I don't see how that combination would result in this character. After a conversation with his analyst, Neo decides to put his beliefs to the test. Time to fly or die. He prepares to jump off a building until Bugs stops him and brings him somewhere to reveal the truth. They show Neo footage from his game and tell him everything in it really happened, 60 years ago. The machine saved him in Trinity for some reason, and it's taken years for Bugs and the others to find him. Partly it was difficult because the machines disguised Neo to look like someone else. Also, it's not explicitly stated, but I can see logic for the machines turning his life into a game. Maybe Neo's subconscious holds onto the memories they want him to forget. To resolve the conflict in his mind, they let the memories remain, but label them a game. Their explanation is interrupted by an attack, and they end up fighting a swarm. The machines no longer relegate themselves to agents, but also disguise themselves as ordinary people. When needed, they can be activated to fight as a swarm. Cool idea, and I like the eyeball effect where they go black and scroll code. But again, the action sequence is disappointed. Neo wakes in the real world, where he's kept in a special pod across from Trinity. He sees her, but is powerless to reach her. He's grabbed by a machine, then brought to Bugs' ship. Morpheus reacquaints him with fighting, and Bugs catches him up on the last 6 decades. At first, Neo's disappointed to find that after all his sacrifices, nothing has changed. But he quickly finds that isn't true. The us versus them mentality of humans versus machines has somewhat eroded. In fact, several machines, or sentients, have joined Bugs' team. And special technology allows programs like Morpheus to take form in the real world. This was a piece of world-building I enjoyed. Similar to other points I've mentioned, it does allude to a theme from the original trilogy. In Reloaded, we discover that the Oracle is a program which first introduces us to the idea that some programs are friendly to humanity. And the ultimate resolution to the trilogy is not humanity triumphing over machines, but Neo brokering peace. That theme of alliance and integration is realized in full by showing what can be built when the two sides work together. We see Io, a city which looks a lot more pleasant than Zion, where, with the help of sentients, they are even creating real food. Although this alludes to an earlier theme, it feels more like progression than repetition. When Neo finally meets the elderly Niobe, it was also interesting to hear about machines fighting each other, something they were driven to after Neo's actions made human batteries a little bit scarcer. This is also where we learn Morpheus's fate. When an attack loomed, he was blind to it because he was convinced that nothing could undo Neo's actions. He was the one, after all. This is another example of Lana ensuring we understood the original trilogy. Morpheus's role in the story was, in part, the blind devotee. He believed in the prophecy of the One so much, he would never question it and would allow it to guide all his actions. This was ultimately a role he needed to serve, but blind devotion is a double-edged sword, and here we see that it cost him his life and likely the lives of others. Up to this point, despite my many criticisms, there were those few things I enjoyed. The intrigue of the first act, and the world building at the start of the second. Then, in the latter half of the movie, both of these things fall away, and all that's left is a muddled, mediocre rescue mission told in a world somewhat resembling the Matrix franchise. Quickly learn that Niobe is very protective of the peace they've achieved in Io. In fact, she was against the idea of trying to rescue Neo. So, just to be safe, imprisons Neo, in a prison which has a handy escape balcony. So, Bug's crew easily frees him. Then, they head into the Matrix to try and free Trinity, too. Inside the Matrix, they run into Smith. Thanks mostly to Groff's performance, I did find myself intrigued any time he was on screen. But I found his motivations muddled and a little hard to understand. I'm sure we could parse his dialogue and decipher it, but unlike the original trilogy, this movie honestly doesn't motivate me to do that. In the dialogue here, Smith makes it clear that the world which trapped him and Neo in false identities was designed by the analyst, Neo's doctor. Smith does not want to be on his leash again and tells Neo to stay out of the Matrix, leave the doctor to him, and stop trying to rescue Trinity. My best guess on his motivation is that Smith is currently enjoying some newfound freedom, and he fears that if Neo goes after the analyst, the doctor may retaliate and put them back in mental prisons. Then some old acquaintances of Neo's show up, the Merovingian and his exiles. This time, the action is constantly interrupted by the Merv's incessant shouting about our obsession with technology, how originality used to matter, and caps it off with the promise that this is not over yet, our sequel franchise spin-off. If this movie worked better as a whole, maybe the Merovingian's characterization would have also worked better. Clearly, it's meant to be parody, but after so much meta-commentary and disappointing action, it was just too much for me at this point. We finally see Neo back in his element, and it's totally undercut by loud repetition of the same commentary we already heard. The fight eventually becomes a one-on-one match between Neo and Smith, one of the better action sequences. It's also interrupted by some monologuing from Smith about the binary nature of things. I think this is more cleanup from Lana to ensure we get that things are not binary. After Bug spelled it out earlier, the villain talks of a binary world, so we associate the idea with villainy, and understand that a binary conception of the world is wrong. When it looks like Neo is losing, he turns the tide with his new force push ability. It feels a little random that this Matrix stripped him of his previous abilities like flying, but for some reason granted him this new one. It's a nitpick which, again, might not stick out if the movie worked better as a whole. After the fight, Neo finally pays Trinity a visit. He tries telling her the truth about how everything in the games is real. It's all interrupted when the analyst shows up and fills in some blanks. The analyst is the programmed form of a machine we met in Revolutions. When he had Neo's dead body before him, he couldn't let the opportunity go to waste. Neo was the anomaly of all anomalies. So he convinced the suits to let him resurrect Neo and Trinity. And he found that if he placed them near each other, but never allowed them to reunite, the never-fulfilled desire created a powerful energy. The analyst explains all this while ironically using bullet time, so he can move freely while Neo is trapped in slow motion. The idea of Neo and Trinity's love being so powerful it's actually an important source of energy for the machines is a little cheesy, but honestly, it's no more ridiculous than the idea of humans as viable power sources to begin with. So I was fine with it as a plot point. Back in the real world, a sentient pays Neo and Niobe a visit. She reveals herself as Sati, a girl Neo met in Revolutions. Her father was the chief engineer at the Anomalium, the resurrection pods. She explains that with Neo gone and power drawn only from Trinity, the Matrix will soon reset to a prior version. But the analyst has stopped the process by convincing the authorities Neo will soon return voluntarily. Because if he doesn't, the analyst will kill Trinity. The analyst's certainty that Neo will return creates an opportunity for humanity to rescue Trinity and fight back. Rather than Neo, they send Bugs, Sati, and Morpheus to the Anomalium. They'll be able to free Trinity, but only on the condition that she wants to leave. Pulling an unwilling mind from the Matrix could destroy it. Earlier, I referred to the rescue mission at the center of this movie as muddled. That's partly because it involves a lot of characters I don't really care about, and stakes that don't feel entirely clear. Think back to the first Matrix. There were definitely some background players like Switch or Dozer, but there were also characters that people remember 20 years later. Besides the obvious, like Morpheus, Neo, Trinity, and Smith, there's Cypher, the Oracle, and Tank. But in this movie, any of the new characters, and even some of the returning ones, were flat and unmemorable. Jessica Henwick is fine in the role, but I never really cared about Bugs. And to be fair, even in the original trilogy, none of the characters are particularly fleshed out. But even minor characters like Tank had desires and hopes that permeated the movie. You could feel their hope that Neo is the one who may help them snatch victory from the machines. Here, it's just never exactly clear what they're fighting for. Bugs pays lip service to the idea that she wants to free more minds from the Matrix, but after the trilogy, the idea was that the 1% who wanted out got out. Anyone left behind was happier for it. And outside the Matrix, in I.O., it seems like things are going really well. So I get that Neo wants to save Trinity, but besides Trinity, there is a hint at higher stakes, which is never made clear. Sati references an extraordinary opportunity, and even Niobe, who was unwilling to take risks earlier, is convinced the mission is worthwhile. Just rescuing Trinity doesn't seem like it would be enough for Niobe. So is she going through with the mission because she wants to prevent the Matrix from rebooting? If so, Neo is willing to give himself up. That would be the least risky path. It seems like Niobe and Sati see this as a potential strike against the machines. But even that seems strange. Things are going pretty well in the real world. There appears to be at least a tenuous peace with the machines. Wouldn't taking over the Matrix risk reigniting the war? Isn't that the last thing Niobe would want? The answer may be in the movie somewhere, but it feels muddled. Inside the Matrix, Neo finds the analyst waiting for him, and they negotiate. The people on Bugs' ship will unplug Neo before they let the analyst take him back. So, Neo insists the analyst let him talk to Trinity. If she wants to stay in the Matrix, Neo will join her back in the Anomalium. But if she wants to leave, the analyst will let them go. At first, Trinity insists on staying for her children and family. But when Chad calls her Tiffany and tries to control her, she snaps and reclaims her identity as Trinity. But of course the analyst can't let them go. He enters bullet time again and prepares to kill Trinity until Smith comes to the rescue. At this point, my assumption is that Smith understands humanity is edging out the upper hand against the analyst. So, if he wants to take out the doctor, another temporary alliance makes sense. But the victory is short-lived, as the analyst activates the swarm to end all swarms. And as much as none of the action in this movie did anything for me, I will say, I thought the idea of turning their swarm into human bombs was a cool idea. Definitely not something I've seen before. Neo's force push and Trinity's motorcycle seemingly bring them to freedom. But in reality, the swarm has drawn them into a kill zone. Cornered by artillery and a never-ending swarm of enemies, they jump off a building. And suddenly, Trinity can fly. Reunited, the two of them share the power of the One and pay the analyst a visit. They rain down some retribution, then promise to take control of the Matrix and make it a better place. Finally, they fly off together and live happily ever after. This ending feels like more cleanup and clarification of themes from the original. Neo and Trinity's love for each other was always important in the movies. It's what led Neo to make a different choice from previous ones, and it's what led Trinity to join him on his journey to the Machine City, a journey which would have failed without her. Any interpretation of the trilogy will come out saying love is a big part, and perhaps the most important part of the equation. However, with Neo outliving Trinity by a few minutes, and Neo acting as humanity's sole representative in the final battle, it's easy to see how someone could walk away thinking Neo alone saved the day. So, once again, Resurrection scrubs away the subtlety and tells us that Trinity plays just as important a role, and even counterbalances the misinterpretation by letting Trinity fly while Neo hangs uselessly, though it ultimately ends with both on equal footing, flying together. From a thematic standpoint, once again, it's not saying anything new, just saying what we already heard, except where it was whispered 20 years ago, now it's shouted. But themes are the things that lie beneath the story. Even if we've heard them before, the right story could make it satisfying to revisit them. In fact, while this movie rails against reboots and retreads, I do think Lana is trying to make a case that they aren't all bad. In reality, we lose people and we grieve. But this reboot lets us bring back two beloved characters. We can resurrect Neo and Trinity to celebrate love, thanks to movie magic and thanks to our current reboot culture. There was some part of me that enjoyed seeing them on screen together, but it was never wholly satisfying. Partly that's because this movie feels so disconnected from the originals. It didn't quite feel like I was seeing Neo and Trinity, it felt more like I was seeing two people who kind of resemble them. Putting aside this movie's status as the fourth in a series, it just didn't work as an individual unit. We spent so little time with Trinity in this movie. I never felt her struggle between life as Tiffany and life as Trinity, so her final revolt fell flat. Similarly, the love between her and Neo depended almost entirely on our memory of it from the original trilogy. There was little in this movie to make me believe they're in love all over again, which it had to do because, like I mentioned, this movie feels like a separate unit from the other three. In fact, my favorite segment would be the 30 minutes where Neo thinks he's crazy, and that 30 minutes is where the movie felt most disconnected from the original. But when we get back to the real world, and to the part of Resurrections that most resembles the other movies, it pales in comparison, especially to the first one. I'd say the same for Reloaded, and maybe I'd say it's on par with Revolutions. If this weren't a Matrix movie, and was instead a straight-to-streaming sci-fi original starring Keanu Reeves and Carrie-Anne Moss, I'd probably judge it a little less harshly, but I'd still only call it a mediocre entry in the genre, with an intriguing start that ultimately devolves into a muddled, uninteresting, and generic sci-fi action rescue mission. So, did I hate it? Not exactly. I do hate it for what it could have been, but I don't think it's a terrible movie. It's just bland, doesn't have much new to say, and from a story or action standpoint, doesn't have much ambition. Anyway, I think we can wrap it up there. If you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for more. With that, thank you for watching, and see you on the next One Take.